Great. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to this RPIW week, which is focusing on pharmacy and the inpatient journey in relation to how that's supported by the pharmacy service. So it's great to have all of you here today, and I think the majority of you are with us throughout the whole of the week, so that'd be great. So we will really get to know each other, and people will not be worried about sitting on the front row, etc., as we go through the week. So my name is Rachel Davis, and I'm your workshop lead. We do have other members of the RPIW team through Click, and there'll be opportunities to everybody to introduce themselves as we move on a little bit within this process. So the thing that I need to do now before I hand over to Paul is just the housekeeping. So we've got a toilet at the back there, which two of them are out of order, so we've got one that's working, and there's one down the corridor on the right. Tea and coffee, just help yourselves whenever you want to. And also, if you could have your phones on silent, vibrate, usual rules. If you need to take a call, if you could take it out of the room, because otherwise it tends to distract other people. We have a sign-in sheet going around, and also the RPIW is something that's very visual. We do use it to promote both your service, but what we do is Click. Therefore, we ask that unless you've got a really, really severe reason why you wouldn't want to be filmed or on any Twitter promotions, etc., please let us know. But there is a consent to be photographed form that's going around at the moment. We can do things like back of heads or whatever else, but it can, you know, you just need to let us know in relation to that if that is a particular issue for you. But hopefully it won't be, or if it is at the moment, it may not be as we continue through the week. You don't have to put your hands up just now. You can let us let one of us know. And I think that's it from me. So I'm going to hand over to Paul, who is going to set the context in relation to why we've chosen this area and what we're hoping to achieve over the course of the week, or what we're going to achieve, actually. That's
Thank you. Hi, everyone. Thanks very much for coming along. I just wanted to just put a bit of context around what we're doing over the next few days. Look at what is the problem. And we're going to focus on discharge patients being told that they're ready for discharge, ready to go home, but also how we help, how we flow, and when we get problems with discharge. And it's a bit of a myth that you're always waiting for pharmacy, because when people have looked at the problem before, if you break it down, the amount of time waiting for pharmacy from the time that somebody's told they're going home, it's only about 13%. Most of it is the time where they're waiting for the doctor to finally assess the paper, write the prescription, sign the forms, and get the prescription down to pharmacy. So I don't want to focus too much on that. And John, and hopefully people on the team, have only done work looking at the perfect week for a hospital pharmacy, looking at working with colleagues across the Northeast. Was this 2017?
2016.
So I did a bit of work on this. And that was based around what's called the SAFER bundle. So it's like having a senior person review the patient as soon as possible, all patients having an agreed discharge date, looking at flow of patients to start as early as possible from when they come into hospital. So as soon as they come in, we're doing meds rec and assessing them, looking at when they're ready for discharge. Looking at early discharges, so people are discharged before midday if possible, and reviewing all patients who've got extended stay. And that's what the SAFER bundle is about. And we looked at that 3 years ago this year now. And there were some successes in that. So this is what's reported in the overall outcome of that. That the MTT working, pharmacists being part of the multidisciplinary teams worked, getting early discharge notifications, and extending the hours of the clinical pharmacy service were all positive and had an impact on patient flow. But some of the things that didn't work were looking at delivery medicines post-discharge, looking at senior managers attending commanding control meetings, and increasing the pharmacy dispensary services. They didn't really contribute so much for patient flow. this winter, we've come to the point again where we're getting really stuck for patient flow and how we're going to help the service run. And we've extended the dispensary hours, but we've also extended our clinical pharmacy hours. And I think the feedback, early feedback, is that, again, is what's having the positive impact, rather than just expanding, repeating more of what we do now. So, the real problem. Oops, that was coming in slowly. Forgot my animation there. So what is the real problem? If you look at what was on the news last year, there's a rise in preventable emergency readmissions to hospital. Emergence, again, Nuffield Trust report, preventable conditions are on the rise, but also getting emergency readmissions, and that's what's driving the issue in the hospital. And the Journal of the American Pharmacists Association, a detailed report came up to 26% of hospital readmissions are preventable and medication-based. So we can put everything in to try and fight the fires, but we really need to tackle what the real issues are and how to try and stop people coming back in after they've been discharged. And the way we do that, it's effective medicines optimization. It's, they've got full principles of medicines optimization that people will be familiar with. Because the best medicine, most effective medicine, is the medicine that somebody takes. We've got patients who don't adhere to medicine. The figures are astounding in terms of the number of medicines dispensed that are not taken. And the NHS England have launched what's called the Medicines Values Programme. Within that, there's some key targets around switching to the best, like on patient safety medicines, there it's looking at polypharmacy and de-prescribing so that we reduce medicines waste. And all that will help to get effective medicines optimization and to stop people being readmitted to hospital after being discharged. So the challenge we've got within pharmacy and within the trust is quite often there's silo working, there's not that communication between different professions and pharmacy, but also between different areas in our pharmacy. We're quite siloed in terms of what different people do in our team, so we just need to look at that. We separate between surgery and medicine, we separate between wards and dispensary, and people like get into little silos. So it's just, what can we do to that? How can we develop as a team to move away from those silos, and how can we develop as an organisation to move away from those silos? We've got opportunity for development. We've got different training available. We've got staff who can develop to do more medicines reconciliation. We can get technicians more involved in, like, maybe some of the higher, like, lower clinical assessments and developing clinical skills amongst technicians. We've got prescribing pharmacists now who can start to prescribe medicines or maybe take the lead on prescribing medicines in some areas. We've got recruitment ongoing. We've had funding to go out for care home pharmacists, so that'll help with the interface between hospital and primary care. We've also got seven GP-based pharmacists that we're recruiting, so they'll rotate between hospital and GP practices, so that'll help with integration work. And Sarah's here today. You're leading on a project on farm outcomes, again, to help with interfaces between primary care and secondary care. So we've got recruitment as a challenge, because there's lots of vacancies that we want to fill, but we've also got resources that we can use as well. So it's looking at how we work as a system as well, because in North Cumbria everyone's aware that we're moving to an integrated healthcare system. So the acute trust and the partnership trust are joining together, and what does that offer us in terms of how we can work with our community hospitals? But also primary care is coming into the integrated healthcare system as well, so how do we interface with the primary care to improve the service for patients? The e-discharge system has been launched, so are we using that most effectively? What are the problems with that? How can we improve it? We've got electronic prescribing on the horizon. We bid in on 31st, that's Thursday, for funding from NHS Improvement to buy in and fund electronic prescribing, electronic medicines administration system. So we need to build that into any service as we develop. And then we've got lots of issues around quality. There's NICE guidelines, Royal Pharmaceutical Society standards for hospital pharmacy service, and we're measured against those. They're there as tools for us, but we need to, like, review those and make sure we're delivering to the national standards. And sustainable finance medicines wastage, if you look at spend on medicines over the last 10 years, it used to be that primary care spending was the highest area for medicine spend. Now, secondary care medicines cost has overtaken primary care. Primary care spending has stayed roughly the same, around about £9 billion a year. Hospital prescribing has just overtaken it. So we need to look at our medicines and make sure we are using them effectively. Okay, just a bit more context. So we've got the North Cumbria Medicine Process Review Emergency Care Intensive Support Team. We want to focus on patient flow, from when patient comes into hospital to when they go home, and how pharmacies help them with that one. How we can work collaboratively. We've got slight different setups in terms of pharmacy in Carlisle and compared to Whitehaven. But then we've got different patient demographics in those two in terms of like the service that we offer them for emergency sort of unplanned care in Carlisle, whereas Whitehaven is moving more to become a planned care unit, but we're still having the A&E in the acute wards. So slightly different demographic, slightly different patient size. So, but we need to work, see how we can work collaboratively between the team. And it's about improving flow through partnership, not just can't do it on our own. It's with the whole health system, with the doctors and nurses primarily, but also with the frailty teams, with the care, the teams that support the discharge teams, and the new team. I'm trying to think of the name of it there. Home First Team, thank you. So it's like how we integrate with those and to have a collaborative approach. I think we have got enthusiastic staff. You're all here voluntarily today and willingly, so that's great. And we've got lots of other colleagues who would like to be here today. So we've got the enthusiasm to build on. And we've already had some of the work that you did a couple of years ago on the perfect week, so we can build on previous improvements. We've got targets that are related to the supply of medicines and helping patients flow around reducing waste, reducing delays in discharge, and reduction in time to take to process prescriptions. And I think we need to get that perfect, which I think we can. But I think the more challenging ones, which will deliver the real benefit to patients and help tackle the readmissions and cut off the problem at sources, that it's trying to prevent hospital readmissions. So how do we get the most out of our pharmacists to do medicines optimization? How do we get the most of our technicians so that we're doing medicines optimization? And are we using our pharmacy support staff appropriately in terms of supply of medicines so that the medicines technicians are providing more of a clinical phase service and the pharmacists as well? So again, having more pharmacy support workers doing different jobs on the ward, sorry, I'm getting into solution mode, will help to free up time for pharmacy technicians to do that better out there. And then after 30 days, 60 days, 90 days, there'll be follow-up with the staff and the CLIC team. But I'll let the CLIC team describe that in more detail, how that works.
Okay.
Is that okay?
Yeah. Any questions for Paul in terms of what we've spoken about? Would you agree in terms of that sort of those are the challenges that you're facing at the moment?
Yeah.
So nothing there that surprised you? No? Okay. And in terms of what we're looking to achieve over the week, any concerns around that at the moment? Any fears?
People feeling excited.